Well, good morning, Midland.
Won't you guys stand and sing some praise and worship with us this morning?
Feel good now, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, that was awesome. I feel really good now. I feel really good. Thank you guys. That was great.
So here's one little secret real quick for all of y'all out there. There's three musicians up here. They are all awesome, but three of them I've known as musicians for like most of their lives at this point. That was the first song we ever played together. When, what were y'all, like seventh grade and ninth grade or something like that? So that's like an old school throwback. Yes, he was 12. He was 12, yes. Yes, so there you go. Pretty awesome, pretty awesome. So glad y'all made it out today. We're going to have hopefully an awesome time in worship alongside one another. When you came in this morning, you did not get a bulletin. You know why you didn't get a bulletin? Because we're trying to save trees. And so we broke our copier. And so we broke the copier so that we couldn't do anything with it this week. Yeah, it just has gone crazy on us and not wanting to do anything. So you're welcome to the digital world. If you want to go on our website, you can click right there, fill out a connection card, let us know you're worshiping with us. You're welcome at any point in the service as announcements may pop up on the screen. And you see those QR codes, just walk on up there and pop that code on your phone and sign in. You know, however you want to do it, it's absolutely fine. Little trick, there's actually one in the back too, so you can even sneak back there if you see it. Yeah, so you know, you just grab you a QR code if you want to check in, let us know you're here this morning. We'd love to know you're here. You can still give online that way as well, but we're so glad you made it out. Take a look at somebody close by, tell them good morning, and we're going to keep on rolling.
Good morning.
pray. God, these are the words we sing this morning. God, reminding ourselves of why we come together. For some of us, God, it truly is to have the words from our mouths to express the gratitude and love that we have for you because of the great love you have for us. God, for some of us, it's to come in and to hear others speak words and to sing words that reassure us that there is a God who loves us. God, for some of us, we're coming in here and we got questions and we're wondering and we'd love for that to be so true. God, it's worthwhile to have our lips speak words of praise to you because you have done something. This morning, God, I pray that in such a way as we come together, your love for us, your plans for us, the reality of who you are, your being, may be found in these moments. Maybe not in something crazy, in something special, but just in the ordinary and in the mundane. Just in the handshakes or the hugs, just in the words that are spoken, because God, we know and we hold to as a people of faith that you are everywhere and at work in all things. And for that, we are so grateful. And yet, because of that, God, we also want to see it and to experience it again and find the fullness of who we are and the fullness of who you are. So, God, we ask it all in your name. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
All right, try that again. Good morning, friends.
Good morning.
That's a little bit more believable. So we've been learning some cool stories and about talking about how God sometimes likes to play hide and seek. Do you know there's some other characters that did some hiding in the Bible? Did you know that? Do you all know who David is? What do you know about David? David hid, okay. That's a solid plan. What else do we know about David? Did you know he was a shepherd? 50-50? That's a pretty awesome story, but that is the story of Joseph. But you know what? I think it's really awesome that you know that story. We're talking about Joseph's rainbow coat up here, and that's an awesome story. So we're going to talk about a king who did some chasing of David before he was a king. What do y'all think? Do you think David was mean? How many of y'all have ever cheated when you play hide and seek? I mean, I feel like there's cheating that happens in hide and seek. How many of you... I'm not going to tell you how to cheat. That's not how this goes. Oh, if you tickle them when they're hiding, that's cheating. It's a good hint. Oh, just don't hide. Just don't hide when you play hide and seek. Oh, if you peek. These are all good answers. We should go read a Bible story and see if any of those answers are in our Bible story. What do y'all think? All right, let's put our hands together. Dear God, thank you for loving me. Help me to love others and value them the way you do. Amen. All right, little friends. And moms and dads, we still need candy. Oh, you took my sound away.
So we do need candy because we have a fall festival coming up. And so if you have candy, if you have a deep desire within you to buy candy, and it's really hard not to, succumb to the temptation. And buy bags of candy and then bring them up here. All right? Does that sound good? We got a fall festival coming up. It's a big time here
at the church. It's one of those times when we come together as a church. We volunteer time to make it happen because we know that we have a big community that's growing all around us that needs a chance to encounter God as well. And we think that here at Midland, we offer that opportunity for people to encounter God in a way that's different than maybe they find in other places. And so we want to offer that invitation for them to come out and get a chance to meet the church and experience and have a good experience out here, to know that just like God has chosen to love us, we are a church that chooses to love all those that we meet. And so Fall Festival is a big time for us. We do need candy. So like I said, if you see candy and you really want to buy it, go for it. Buy it and then bring it up here, drop it off at the church. You can bring it on a Sunday morning, and we'll be collecting the candy. If you see those little things that have like the little gift things in them as well, you know, like spider rings or whatever, Rebecca says you can bring those too. So, you know, whichever ones you want to get, if you can bring some of those up there, those are the prizes for the games that we'll have going on. We also have the market happening there. So Larry Klein, who heads up the Midland Market for us here at the church, told me to let y'all know if you're early and you love getting up early in the morning, especially on a Saturday, that he could really use your help out there. 7:30, they're going to be doing big setup stuff for market, which gets started at 9. For us here at the church, we usually get started between 8 and 8:30 with our big church side set up. And so if you want to sleep in a little bit later, that's fine. You can just come and help on the church side, or you can come early, help Larry, and then walk across and help the church. If you want to get signed up for a certain time, let Dominic know. Dominic's right there. He's waving at you right now. That's Dominic. He is the guy that heads up Fall Festival for us this year, making sure we got volunteers everywhere we need them. He's also the one that we can sick on you to go get you and find you and bring you in. All right, isn't that right, Dominic? That's how it works? Yeah. And but no, we will need help. If you're not an early morning person, that's fine. Don't worry about getting up early in the morning. Come on in. You can volunteer for an hour during the Fall Festival to help make some part of it work, and then enjoy the rest of it with your family. Or if you're just one of those folks and you love the Fall Festival so much you need every minute of it, come on out at 11 o'clock and enjoy Fall Festival till 2 o'clock, and then stay after and help clean up. All right? You can do it either way you want to. Lots of options are out there. We just really will need the help of many folks to make this happen. So go on. If you're available on that day, let us know when works for you so we can get this all taken care of and enjoy doing what we say we exist to do, which is be a church that's passionately growing together to reach our community for Christ. Also, we have stuff going on with our kids and youth on Wednesday nights. So if you want to come and enjoy some amazing time, we got our young kids. We have two great groups of our youngest of the young to our young but older kids, if that makes sense, you know, that get together singing songs, learning about Jesus, and also getting ready for the Christmas production, which is going to be taking place on December 14th, right here in this room on this stage, as they're going to tell the Christmas story through the mouths of kids, which is always hilarious, and this is a great one for us to get to experience. Bring your kids up there, tell your grandkids to come up here, grab your neighbors if you want to. We have music available for them where they can pull it up and you can listen to it in your car. If you don't have that link and you need it, just let me know. I'll get it to you. That way you can jam to the music. I know it's October now. It's time to turn the Christmas music on. All right? And you can enjoy the songs and your kids can learn them as well. So I think that's got most of that part. Bible study happening today here at the church. Also have one that we've gotten started back at our house again. So if you're interested in joining up with Bible study, let us know. We will get you connected. Anything I'm missing? Cool. So series going on right now, we're looking at these little things in life, and it's crazy how the little things can have such a big impact. Have y'all noticed this in your life yet, since we've been kind of looking at it the past few weeks, of this idea that when you look at the things in life, they're small, they're little, just a little bit of that, a little bit of that, but at some point they really begin, we said, to add up and pack quite a punch. Anybody noticed it yet in your life? No? Yeah, you noticed it? If you haven't, good for you. If you haven't been here, then you don't have to worry about noticing it yet. But after today, you know, maybe you'll start noticing this. There's something crazy about how the little things in life add up and can pack quite a punch. And the deal is, y'all know this, it can be for better or for worse. There's those times when those little things that don't seem to count for much begin to do something. You go, never expected something this amazing happening in my life. Y'all been there before? It's like that time when somebody walked up to you and doesn't really mean to, but says something, man, it just hits your heart and you go, this is the most amazing day ever. You know, they have no idea that what they said mattered that much, but it just made your day. You had these before? Just those little things. You ever had the other way around when that person comes up to you and says that thing and it ruins your day too? You know, it's on the other side. Little things, for better or worse, you know, are like really good at impacting our lives. We have this kind of theme verse that we're looking at. It comes from Ephesians chapter 3, a letter that was written, we're not really sure if Paul wrote it or if it was by a Pauline school, but it was later writing in the Pauline literature. But it comes from Ephesians, a letter that went out to all the churches in this area. And in chapter 3, verse 20, we read these words. We read them each week. And it says, now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine. And it's this way of looking at who God is through Jesus Christ. And so as we have gone through each week, just so you know, not to ruin the ending for you again, like this is where we're going to end today as well. And each week leads us back to this very verse right here. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine. We got things started there. First little kind of thing of life that we looked at, we said, what you got goes a long way. Sometimes we feel like I don't have much. I just got this, that. We looked at that story. You remember the story, like little boy, and he's probably not that little. He's probably, you know, a little older, probably like one of our young youth around here that has the loaves of bread and the fish for his lunch that day. You remember that? And Jesus says, hey guys, we need to feed these people. Go get me some food. And they're like, where are we going to get food from? And one guy, you know, Andrew's like, maybe sarcastically in John's account of this, you know, what, this kid's got, you know, some bread and some fish. You think that'll be good enough, Jesus? I mean, come on, he's got lunch, you know, for 5,000 people. And Jesus goes, perfect. Have everybody sit down, we'll feed them. Remember that story? It's great. It's great. The what you got goes a long way. But the crazy thing about it is it doesn't stop there, that just what you got goes a long way. If you keep reading through that story and you look at it, we found it so true that we could stop here and that's great and this is good, but there's something even better. We said that don't get so focused on the little things that you miss the best thing. And this is what we can do when we read some of the stories, the accounts of Jesus's life. This is what we can do in our own lives and get stuck on those things. And even though it may be great, we can still miss the bigger one. Because as we read, we said, you know, what you got goes a long way, but what you're given is always enough. And see, that's what brought us back to that place where sometimes we feel like I still don't have enough. That you say what I got goes a long way, but it doesn't go far enough. And yet we said, but what you're given, not what you got, but what you're given is always enough. And it comes back to that verse that we read each week that says, now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine. And that's why it's always enough. She took us to next week, and how many of y'all are really good with words that you speak? You're very confident in the things you say. You would never let anything slip out of your mouth. And who here is ready to confess sins now and then get on with the sermon, right? You know what I'm saying? We've all had that word slip out, didn't mean it. You know, we try to some way say, well, the reason I said it was, we try to justify our things. We found it to be true that our tongues have power like nothing else. In fact, this is what we found, you know, in the story. As James is writing about the tongue and he uses these three great illustrations and he says, all of these things in life are not capable of doing anything but this, except for your tongue. Your tongue can do a lot of good stuff and a lot of bad stuff. And we're like, amen to that, weren't we? There's so many things in life, they can only do one thing, but not your tongue. Your tongue can do lots of things, lots of really good things and lots of really bad things. These words that we use, what we choose to say, our tongues have power like nothing else. And then we say, what you say goes a long way. And as you begin to think about this, you know, we can kind of understand it. We can come to that place of saying, well, I'm only going to speak words of love. I'm only going to speak encouraging words to others. How many of y'all have ever been here before? Like, yeah, my words are powerful. I got that now. I'm only going to say words that are good for the other. And then you get to your car and you realize somebody threw their door open and now your door doesn't look the same. You know what I'm talking about? And suddenly your encouraging words got swallowed up. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm talking about? Like just when you've made the decision, something else compels you to go in the other direction. And this isn't new. In fact, as you're reading in James, it's like this very negative kind of, you know, reading in it. You come to this place of going, I don't know if I feel better or worse from going to church in hearing this reading from James, because he says in it, no human being can tame the tongue. And we could leave it there and all of us just go, to heck with it, guys. What comes out, comes out. Until we have to suffer the consequences of what came out. You know what I'm talking about? They're like, dang it, I shouldn't have just gone, you know, what comes out, comes out. Which brought us back to that same place again. You know, the words we speak matter a lot. And we have to be a people willing to say, you know, I want to speak words of encouragement, and I want to speak words of love for the other. And yet I know I'll have those times when I won't get it right. I'll say the wrong words at the wrong time. And yet, what we have in our heads, instead of quitting and giving up, we go to Him who's able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine. And though we may not be able to rein in our tongues, we believe that God can work through us and the words that come out of our mouths. And He can work in our hearts, maybe even change those words that come out of our mouths. It's not because of us. It's not because we'll try hard enough or believe it good enough, but because God is at work in us. And when we take a moment to go, now to You who can do immeasurably more than all I ask or imagine, maybe we stand a chance and maybe we won't quit. Brings us to this morning. This morning, we're going to have a little bit of fun going into an area of life that probably all of us could name, but a lot of us don't want to name, is what's that little thing that can take over everything in your life? What's that little thing that can take over everything in your life? For some of us, it's like that little bit of regret. I said something and I didn't want it to come out of my mouth, just like we talked about last week. And you're trying to figure out how to fix those words. Some of us just go, I'm so sorry, like that shouldn't have come out of my mouth. Some of us go, well, what I meant was, you know what I'm talking about? And you dig a deeper hole, ever been told that? And like, you're just digging on, just keep on digging up. They just look at you like this, you know, and you're like, shut my mouth. These little things that lead to regret. You know, when I was writing them down, I was like, okay, we got regret that comes in here. We got some sadness that can come into life. Those little things that you just build up, those offhanded comments, that little picture or that short video, that little peek, that pill, that sniff, that dollar, those little things that become the big things. Have you ever seen people try to deal with the little things in their life and they tell you it's just a little thing? And you're looking at it and you're going, I don't look so little to me. You ever been here before? It's looking at somebody else's life that we're better at this than our own most of the time. Have you noticed? Like, we can look at somebody else and be like, that ain't a little thing. That's a big thing. Like, oh, no, this is not a problem. I know a lot of people struggle with this, but not me. Look, I have been dealing with this forever. I keep it in control. You know, you're like, oh, okay. If that's called in control for you, you've been here before? You've seen this in somebody else's life? How many of you have had it happen in your own life? And you spend your time going, I got this, it's fine. I know people say this is dangerous, this can put me in a bad spot, I know this can lead to this, but you know what, I am fine. You've been there before. Anybody been here before? I think as you come to these places, you come to a place where maybe we could call it arrogance. Y'all down with that today? That's gonna be a little bit of our focus, all right, arrogance. There's times when you go, you might not be able to handle it. This might be a problem for you, but not for me. And a little arrogance drives us to take it into our own hands. I can handle it. I can deal with whatever we just talked about. I got this down. Now, arrogance has this way to keep some of us from confronting and acknowledging to others that we've messed up. And so we just keep messing up, and we keep messing up. But how many of you have ever found yourself where at some point it becomes obvious to others as well, and you need to fix the problem? And now others are beginning to find out about it, and because of the very arrogance that had you think, I can control this, and I won't have a problem like other people have with this, that same arrogance is the one that compels you to think, but I can still fix this, and fix it for others to see and know that I still am in control. And arrogance drives some of us to confess and acknowledge. You ever met those people? You have that group of people, that's not a problem for me. You know, that's a problem for you, right? You have that other group of people that go, oh my gosh, I am so sorry. My heart just hurts so bad because I hurt you so bad. You ever met these people before? Have you met these? Now, I'm not saying this is everybody. I'm just saying those people. Those people who do this, who have this arrogance that drives them to confess and to acknowledge that, you know what, I've got a problem in my life. With the plan to get off the hook. You know these people? And they're like, if I tell my sob story just the right way, and you know this because you've probably been on the receiving end. If you haven't done it, good for you. You're holier than most, all right? But all of us, I think, at some point have been on the receiving end of this one, where somebody comes to us because they got busted, and like, I am so sorry, I blah, 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 I can't believe I, da, 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 da. And the whole time, what they're really trying to do is now put it on you, because you're feeling this urge, like you are so ticked off when you found out about them. You know, you get there and they start saying this, like, oh my gosh, I'm so sorry. And you're trying to fix their problem for them. You ever been here before? And you're like, oh, it is okay. Why am I saying it's okay? It's not okay, but I feel like it's okay now. You know what I'm talking about? It's crazy how this works, and people know it. And they get themselves off the hook. In fact, not only do they get themselves off the hook and have no plans of changing anything about what they've said or done, but they are imposing on you a big burden to deal with their problems. Arrogance. 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 I think, and I'm not an expert on this, but I think a little arrogance reveals quite a big ego. And have you ever noticed that as you go through this in life and you come to that place where you begin to acknowledge that there's something about a big ego, some arrogance that's driving things to happen, that we want to create boundaries. I've messed up, so I need to create boundaries, so we begin to draw lines. You know, okay, I'm not going to do this, I'm not going to do this, or I'll only do this much. And you know what I'm talking about. Y'all ever done this before? You create your boundaries kind of in life, and those are good, but have you ever noticed there's something about when you draw a line somewhere, you push the line, you know? And then you go, well, I mean, I think I was just having a tough day when I set these boundaries originally, and this is really crazy. I can probably go on, and we push the boundary a little bit. You ever notice this? And then we push it a little bit more, and if you ever take a moment to be real with yourself, and you look back 6 months, and you go, what you originally had set out and planned to do, that boundary you had drawn in life, is now way far away from the new boundary you have. And you've pushed, and you've pushed, and you've pushed, and you've pushed that boundary. You've been there before. You've seen this happen in your own life, seen it happen in other people's lives, breaks your heart for them, and you're trying to fix it for them. You're like, oh yeah, I don't know if that's a good idea. You're really pushing some of these. But this is how we like to deal with it. I'm going to put up my boundaries. And yet we push them until we mess it all up again. And then you have this other side of things. And maybe you've been on this before. The people in life who have another form of arrogance, right? Their form of arrogance comes up on these boundaries because they draw stricter and stricter and stricter and stricter boundaries, and they're not just for them, but they're for you too. There's not just expectations for how they're going to live their lives, but how you should live your life too. You ever met these people? And they have these rules of what you should do and what you shouldn't do, and anytime you're around them, your life's miserable. And you go, how can your life not be miserable? Because you, all you do is draw lines about what you can't do all the time. You ever met these people before? And they now have a new form of arrogance, which is to prove I am better than you because I can do all this and you can't. The opposite end. Have you all noticed how this works? Each week we find it going in both directions. The people who have the arrogance to think that that's not a problem for me. So the people who have the arrogance to think they can draw up the boundaries in such a way to prove they're better than you. As we begin to look at this going on in life, we say there's this drive to keep these stricter guidelines is fueled by the very same arrogance. Arrogance and ego is what I want to look at today as we read Paul's letter to the Galatians. Now, again, kind of refresh your mind if you don't know much about this letter. The church in Galatia were a bunch of Gentiles. They were not Jewish. Gentile means anything that's not Jewish when you read through the Bible. So if somebody says they're a Gentile, that means they weren't Jewish. Two categories is how they like to divide it up. These were people that had some of their own gods kind of thing, their own form of religions going on there, but they weren't Jewish. And Paul is not trying to go see the people in Galatia. He's going to see some other folks, but he has some sickness that comes over him and gets stuck in Galatia with these sorry folks who don't have the background of the strong Jewish faith and have them sorry pagan rituals going on around there. And yet they're the very people who take Paul in, who care for him and nurse him back to his health. Pretty amazing how that could happen, isn't it? Now, the thing about this is why Paul's there. Paul can't help it. He has to tell them about Jesus. And so he begins to share this story, and people's hearts are moved, and lives are changed, and they begin to join this Jesus movement there in Galatia. Well, later on, as Paul's continued on his journey, he finds out that this group of missionaries have come in, Jewish missionaries, who have also turned to Jesus, but who think there's no way to separate out this new faith in Jesus as the Messiah and the Redeemer from the law. And so, therefore, you got to keep the law, do all these things we've been doing in the Jewish tradition, and now have faith in Jesus. And they bring this message to the people in Galatia. Paul finds out about it and talk about being ticked. He's very ticked. We'll read part of that today. And if you don't think that's ever in the Bible, you'll see that, yes, that is in the Bible. It's one of those moments. It's great. You're going to love it. Some of our folks are going to really love it. Some of you are going to feel very uneasy today. I'm just kind of warning you now. All right? Close your ears. I'll try to give you a warning before we read that part. And Paul speaks to them and calls out this desire to bring it into our own hands. And he gets it started like this. Galatians chapter 5, getting towards the end of the letter. He says, it is for freedom that Christ has set you free. Hold on to that one, because that's very important to come later, because you'll have another word popping up. It is for what? For freedom. Christ set you free. You are created to be free, and therefore, Christ has set you free. We're not trying to go, hey, you know, he set you free so you can make sure you always do blah, 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 blah. It's for freedom that you have been set free. The importance of freedom being emphasized here at the letter is ending. Stand firm then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. The rules, the laws, the expectations, what you got to do. Don't let yourself be burdened by that. Don't let them talk you into it. Don't let them convince you if you want to be a real Christian. Right? You want to be a real follower of Jesus. Don't let them put a burden on you, because it is for what? Freedom that who? Christ has set you free. All right, that's how he gets this started. Mark my words, I, Paul, tell you, can you tell it like we added that exclamation point? That's not in the Greek, all right, but we really think he's upset. I, Paul, tell you that if you let yourselves be circumcised, here's our issue. Here's the issue. Now, how many of y'all are like, that's our issue too? When we sit down at the dinner table at night, this is the one that always comes up. We begin to argue about it. You know, we're just back and forth at each other all night long, sitting around the table. I mean, don't even get around me with my friends or my coworkers, even worse. You don't even know where they come from, you know? No, we don't talk about it anymore, do you? I mean, maybe occasionally you've had some conversation, you know, with like, what's the best thing to do when you have a kid? You've maybe had that conversation, but this is not what we sit around. You don't turn on the news and go, yep, I knew it. I knew these people would be saying this about circumcision. You don't have that happen. So what I want you to do today is I want you to take that one that sticks out in your head. I want you to plug it in for circumcision this week. What's our hot topic? What's the one that grabs you every single time and you can't let it go? If somebody mentions it, you're like, you feel it start like boiling up inside of you. You're like, oh, you better say, you know? What's yours? Because that's what this was for them. Circumcision was that thing that defined who you are. Either you're for it or you're against it. Either you're in or you're out, because this is what determines is how you feel about circumcision. Very big deal. This is what they're having this big argument about. And so Paul says, I need to address this. Mark my words. I, Paul, tell you that if you let yourselves be circumcised, Christ will be of what? No value to you at all. So now we're putting this thing complete opposite sides here. Christ and circumcision. Again, I declare to every man who lets himself be circumcised that he is now what? Obligated to obey the whole law. You want to buy into what these guys are telling you, that if you really want to be a Christian, you really want to be a follower of Jesus, you got to be circumcised? Well, if you want to go that direction, it's not just circumcision, you get the whole law. And by the way, there's a lot of law around there. We got it too, right? You who are trying to be justified by the law have been alienated from Christ. You have fallen away from grace. Do you think Paul thinks the law is a very important thing for us to make sure everybody's getting it right? I'm going to say no on that one, right? Paul's pretty ticked, and you can already tell he's pretty ticked. He's going to the extreme of pushing it. He's like, man, you want a rule? You want a rule? Get them all. You get them all. You pick one rule, you get all the rules. You pick one law, you get all the laws. You want to be circumcised? You think you got to be circumcised to be a part of this Jesus movement? Well, then you got to take the whole law. Go read it. Yeah, it's long, and it gets weird sometimes. That's right, but it's all you now. And if you haven't read it, it does get weird. All right, go read it sometimes. Back in the Old Testament, those first five books, you know, read some Leviticus in there. It's good, it's good. You who are trying to be justified, made right by what you do, have been alienated from Christ. You have missed out on what Jesus is all about. You have done what? Fallen away from, oh my gosh,
How many are sitting around here? He goes, I know I stand in need of that. Dadgummit, I'm going to mess it up. I need some of that grace for sure. When you buy into the rule, you've fallen away and you miss this. He says this. He says, for through the Spirit, we eagerly await by what? Faith. Take it off of yourself, because faith is not about you. Faith is about someone else. It is by faith the righteousness for which we hope. This is a difficult part, because not many of us like the idea of eagerly waiting for what is to come. We want it now. And this is how it goes for a lot of us a lot of times. Is I don't want to have to wait to see what is to come. I want to take it into my own hands, which goes with that key word of the day, which is arrogance. That's right. I'm going to take it into my own hands, and I will do what needs to be done. And so we need a law. We need a rule to keep so I can rub it in your face that I'm getting it right and you're not. Can I get an amen? Because this is how we operate, isn't it? Somebody's picked their rule for you, and they've called you out, and they've told you how they do it, and they keep it, and they want to know why you can't, don't they? Have you done it to somebody else? I can go through and name some of my favorites, right? I got my set that you better get right, you know? For through the Spirit, not through us, but through God at work in our lives, we eagerly await. We are having to be patient to look to what is to come, by faith, not sitting on ourselves, the righteousness for which we hope. He goes on to say this and specify a little bit more. It's for in Christ Jesus. There's where this idea of faith comes in. It's what Christ has done. Neither circumcision nor uncircumcision has any value. We don't care one way or the other. The only thing that counts is what? Faith expressing itself through, oh my gosh, love. This is the part that gets me in the Bible, and this is the part that gets me when I look at our world around us. This is what gets me when I hear what churches have to say in regard to things happening in the world around us. And I begin to ask the question, where does it fit into this statement? What is our current circumcision debate that has to be solved at the expense of others when the only thing that counts is faith expressing itself in love? You're running a good race. Who cut in on you to keep you from obeying the truth? And I love this. How many of y'all have ever had somebody, this idea of cutting in on you? If you've ever done a race and you've had somebody, I watched yesterday, great race, finished it up this morning, by the way, Ironman World Championship, all right? Women were on Thursday, men were yesterday. Awesome. It's my thing. I love triathlons. All right. It was happening. And as they're starting the run, there's these three guys running together. And I swear it looks like one of them trips the other guy. Right. And he like stumbles and he doesn't fall down, but he comes up and he's saying words. I'm like, did he trip on his own feet or did that guy trip him? Was he saying, dude, I about busted my face. I'm so clumsy. I shouldn't have biked so hard. Or is he looking at this guy and using choice words to tell him he better not do it again? You know, like, cause you can't hear what they're saying. And this is where it comes into, like, you're running a good race. This guy was in second place, right? And now he gets tripped. Who cut in on you to keep you from, and I love this part, obeying the truth? Because you know what? I found out this about you. You need something to obey. Because you want it to come back on yourself. So Paul uses this word, to obey the truth. Who cut in on you to keep you from obeying the truth? And what is the truth in all this? The truth is found in the fact that it's not about you. Have you noticed that yet? Don't worry, it's coming some more. It's about what? Jesus Christ. It's about what has been done for you. Faith expressing itself in love. That kind of persuasion does not come from the one who calls you. Whenever you feel like there's this call to obey it and do it this way and do it, it's not coming from the one who calls you. A little yeast works through the whole batch of dough, but it spreads quickly. We get a little word in, it spreads quickly. And other people grab it, other people grab it, and pretty soon we've created. We don't have that old rules. I love this one. Like, here's what the rules were. These are not worthwhile. But these are.
Y'all ever been here before? You're like, oh, it's a new set. That's what we're talking about. I had no idea. I thought we had overcome this idea. There's something else to drive me, and not this idea of, like, how do I get everything right, but how am I driven by love? But no, we like to create a new set, and this is where it comes from. A little yeast works its way through a whole batch of dough. So we come up with our new list. Not those. Who cares about what kind of meat you eat? You eat the good stuff, all right? Nobody cares about that. Who cares about when you go to the bathroom and where you go to the bathroom? You know, you just find you a good spot, right? That's what they say they do in San Francisco or something like that. I don't know. Y'all listen to this news? You know? Just because the Bible said that, don't worry about that. But there's this other one, though, and it really matters. Circumcision. Put it back at the table talk. I am confident in the Lord that you will take no other view. The one who is throwing you into confusion, whoever that may be, and this is Paul being sarcastic, because everybody knows he knows who he's talking about, because he's already mentioned them earlier in this letter, right? It's those dadgum missionaries who've come over here that told you you've got to obey the law too. Will have to pay the penalty. That's who I want to have to suffer. I want them to have to pay the penalty. Brothers and sisters, if I'm still preaching circumcision, why am I still being persecuted? In that case, the offense of the cross has been abolished. The cross is offensive because the cross removes it from you and pins it on an amazing Savior who did something for you. That's what we don't like. I need it in my court. I want to control it, and I want to do it, and I want the praise for it when it gets done. Maybe not by everybody, but at least by a couple people or myself. Brothers and sisters, I'm still preaching circumcision. Why am I still being persecuted? In that case, the offense of the cross has been abolished. If I'm ever putting it back on you and what you do, if I'm ever putting it back on myself and what I do, I have abolished the cross. I have removed it from the equation. I have taken Jesus out of what has been done. As for those agitators, here it is. Close your eyes. You know, don't read it. I wish they would go the whole way and emasculate themselves. Do y'all know what that means? That's in the Bible. I know. Paul's ticked. You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. It's awesome. But do not use your freedom to indulge in the flesh. Rather, do what? Serve one another humbly in love. All of you who are sitting around like, I can't stand when preachers preach this. You're just going to let people do whatever they want to and think that's okay? No, because when you're driven by love, life changes. And the way you see things change, you don't need a set of rules to tell you what you can and can't do. When you're driven by love, according to this at least, this is when you stand a chance of experiencing life to the fullest. This is when you stand a chance of offering life for others to experience as well. But do not use your freedom to indulge your flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly. What was that word we've been talking about earlier? Arrogant. Here we go. Arrogance removed. Because love's not found in arrogance. Love is found in humility. Because at the end of the day, it's not about what I'm going to achieve and what rules I can keep. It's about what has been done for me and me now responding in a life filled with love. For the entire law, if you like law, you like rules, pick yours, put them up on the wall, is fulfilled in keeping this one command: love your neighbor as yourself. Man. How many of you are going, we need to hear that more oftentimes right now? This is the way he ends. And this is the one that hurts my heart when I read it, because I go, you want to talk about what's true? You want to hear our current circumstances in life defined so well? Right here. Paul wrote it a very long time ago. If you bite and devour each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed by each other. And that's what we'd rather do. That's what we would rather do these days. We'd rather bite and devour one another. We'd rather call you out and pin you on it. Watch out. You'll be destroyed by each other. There's something about arrogance. There's something about an ego that has no place for love in it. You see, a little arrogance reveals a big ego. And when it comes down to this idea that I think matters so much, this idea that we read here, it shows up again, this idea that we like and we want this right, is that's obeying the truth. Do you remember that part in the Bible that we love to quote, except for when it comes to this, right? We love to quote this to people when they're trying to talk about how, you know, other faiths stand a chance. Like, oh, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth. Were we obeying the truth? I think that's when we lay it in the hands of Jesus. Obeying the truth is found in the offense of the cross. Obeying the truth is found in the offense, an unwillingness to take it into my own hands, but to leave it into the hands of what Jesus has done in the life where Jesus showed us love. Obeying the truth is the very act of humbling oneself and leaving it all on Jesus. You talk about humility, you talk about arrogance. You know, talk about us proving it ourselves and getting it right ourselves, you know, push the other way. When you do this, you're no longer driven by arrogance. You are driven by love. I think that's what we're called to be about. I think as we look at what comes our way in life, it's not easy. And in our world today, you can even say it's not Christian. And yet you can't separate what we do and the words we speak from humility and a willingness to love. That is what we are called to. And if you have to call that into question, then we have missed it. When you're driven by love, the entire law is fulfilled. Now, as we go through and wrap it up here this morning, I think it's so true for so many of us. It's hard to do because it takes out of my hands. And because we have something within us that drives us with this whole idea maybe of a little arrogance drives us to take it into our own hands. And all of us suffer from this at some point or another, at some place or another, in some topic or another, at some time in life or another. And yet this is the part that we come back to end every week. The offense of the cross brings us to say, you all say it with me this morning? Or do we need to keep practicing a couple more weeks? Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine. Because that's what it comes back to. That's what we're called to. That's life lived out for the glory of the Creator and the Sustainer of us all. Let's pray. God, it's so difficult. And we need to figure it out and nail it down. We need to draw our boundaries, put up the parameters, and God, have some way to better define it. And it makes sense. We do need boundaries in life, and we know that. If we don't create boundaries, God, we can get ourselves in such a mess. And yet, God, we also know that we are people who are bound to push boundaries as we get an opportunity to. Arrogance can drive us. God, we also know that when we do get some good boundaries drawn and people notice that we are, God, keeping the rules, we're bound to create some stricter ones and some stricter ones, and suddenly our drive, God, is once again arrogance to prove what we can do. And yet, God, we're called to something so much better than that, and yet it's so difficult, and it's just not natural for us a lot of times. But this morning, God, I pray, as we look at what we're supposed to do, God, what that main topic that sat in our heads this morning was, how do I address this? How do I respond? We understand, God, it's not about me figuring it out. It's not me fixing, but it's God, it's a call for me to love. Wow! Man, the Spirit was moving, and then my ears hurt, you know what I'm saying? But God, we pray in the midst of whatever distractions can come our way in life, that God, we're a people filled with your love, and that God, as the decision has to be made what to do and how to do it, we are a people driven by love. And God, when we can't figure it out, and we can't figure out how that idea of love really plays out, as we begin to make excuses for what we say and what we do, may we be a people who are willing to come back and say, but I'm going to be a person that tries to figure out how to love, because you are the one who can do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine. It's in your name we pray. Amen. We had the ushers come up and pass those offering plates around this morning. Drop your, don't drop your connection cards in there. You drop your connection cards in there as you fill it out in the pews. Drop your offering in there this morning. We're going to stand together, sing this last song.
Touching every heart, I worship you, I worship you. You are here, healing every heart, I worship you, I worship you. I worship you.
Go forth in peace, in the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, and communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. We'll see y'all next week.